All right. Hello and welcome to another SalesPOP Expert Inside interview. My name is John Golden from SalesPOP, online sales magazine and Pipeliner CRM. And today I am joined by Curt Crosby from Velas Coaching. How are you doing, Curt?
Doing well. Thank you. Thanks for having me.
And what part of the country are you in today?
I am in, cloudy Burlingame, California, the San Francisco Bay Area.
Oh, very well. Not well. I spent some of my first years in the States all those years ago, like 21, 22 years ago. I spent in Silicon Valley during the dot-com era and actually lived for a short while in Burlingame. So, not well.
There you go. Very good.
And I'm here in actually also a bit of a cloudy San Diego.
Wow. And that's unusual for San Diego.
And it is, as I say, I mean, it's been raining for a couple of days. But the difference between here and where I grew up in Dublin, in Ireland, is in Ireland, we're lucky we only have one rainy season. The unfortunate part is it starts on January 1st and ends on December 31st. Whereas here, yeah, we get rain for a couple of days, but you know the sun will come out and be out for 11 and a half months after that.
Exactly. We are spoiled with our weather normally.
Yeah. For sure. All right. So Curt's over 30 plus years of practical leadership experience in the high-tech industry. He's held positions in a number of organizations like Sun Microsystems, Hitachi Data Systems, Blue Coat Systems, which is now Symantec. And you're now a leadership coach. You really focus on coaching senior leaders. And that's what we wanted to talk about today is, number one is, when you talk about leadership coaching, because I think it's a term, I mean, people understand coaching, leadership coaching, but I'm not sure everybody really understands what it is in practice, right? So first of all, I'd like to understand what leadership coaching is about and what the objectives of it are.
Right. Yeah, no, great question. You know, I think that there are many definitions of leadership coaching. I think if I were to frame it in a way that works best for the practices that I'm involved in, is it's really about taking very successful leaders and helping them just hone their skills a bit in order to continue to make them successful. This is really about recognizing that there are aspects of their leadership characteristics that they may be challenged to just work on a little bit and provide an opportunity for their stakeholders, those people that surround them, be it their leaders, their peers, their cross-functional colleagues, their direct reports, to recognize that they value the opportunity for growth and development themselves. So it's a walk the talk kind of aspect.
So do you find it's tough for some leaders to kind of admit that they may need some coaching or professional development? Because let's face it, I mean, most people in leadership positions are high achievers, or they worked hard to get where they are, and it's naturally, you know, for all of us at times, it's natural to sort of go, well, if I sort of say I need coaching, I'm admitting there are deficiencies, and sometimes that's a hard thing for people to do, right?
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, there are three characteristics or elements of a successful coaching engagement that I walk my leaders through right at the start of a coaching engagement. I basically say three main elements: courage. You had the courage to get in front of me and talk about, obviously, your opportunity here. Maybe there are blind spots or gaps that you have in your particular career path that bring you here. The second one is humility, the ability to admit that some changes are necessary, that perceptions of others about your behavior as a leader has the opportunity for growth. And the third piece is discipline. It's discipline to make some changes in your leadership style and to sort of up the ante as far as what you have to offer for your team, your organization, and your company. So I really like to start off with a recognition that the leaders here are truly here with a level of self-awareness, a level of humility and courage to take on the opportunity to grow as a leader. Most of the time, John, I don't have a lot of resistance. I don't have a lot of, but I do this well. And no, however, I'm doing these things. Most of the time when they get to me, they've self-identified the opportunity.
Right. And it's interesting too, if you think about it, when you get into a leadership position, or the higher you go in any organization, it's like when you're at other levels, you're sometimes, you know, waiting, or the company is saying, okay, you know, Curt, let's put you into this training. You need this kind of development. The higher up you go, the more you're really kind of accountable for yourself. And the higher you go in an organization, sometimes, you know, there's nobody there who's going to hold your hand or is going to say, oh, listen, we should do this for you. You have to kind of invest in yourself.
Well, and, you know, it's somewhat becoming overused as a cliched statement as everyone needs a coach. I mean, if you read Trillion Dollar Coach by Eric Schmidt, former CEO of, of Google, president of Google, he's basically, you know, he basically came to the conclusion that even though he felt he was a very successful leader, his board had said, hey, you can use a coach. And once he had the opportunity to work with a coach, he recognized some of his opportunities, his blind spots. So these are highly successful leaders that I work with and that other coaches work with. And, you know, it's often, John, sometimes about the idea of what got you here won't necessarily get you there. And Marshall Goldsmith, obviously a guru and thinker 50 in the leadership space, has coined that term and has a book written about that. But it really is true. I mean, these are often just little tweaks that leaders have to make in order to elevate themselves to maybe that next level.
Yeah. And Marshall has been on this show, and obviously you're a certified Marshall Goldsmith coach. And I highly recommend Marshall Goldsmith and the coaches he has nurtured. They're always excellent. So tell me a little bit about your approach then. If you were taking on, say, me as a coaching subject or client,
sure.
What can I expect from it?
Yeah. I mean, the methodology that we typically employ at Velis and that I use almost religiously is really the stakeholder-centered approach. Yeah. So that methodology basically says, it's not about how I identify the skills you need to work on. It's not how you necessarily self-identify the skills, but we look at the perception of others. We look at those that surround you as the client, your peers, your direct reports, your cross-functional colleagues, your leaders. And what I would do basically is interview them. It can be in the form of assessment tools. It can be behavioral interviews. I like to do face-to-face interviews when I talk to my clients, stakeholders. And I basically ask, what are this individual's strengths? What are his areas of opportunities? What environments does he work best in? What environments does he work worst in? And get a kind of an overall picture of the perception of others, individuals, of your characteristics of leadership behavior. With all of that, I put together a report. You and I debrief it together. And through your self-awareness and through a little bit of my coaching, I help you sort of identify those things that are perceived as areas of opportunity for you, building on your strengths and looking at those areas of opportunity. And then a coaching plan is made, and I help you make it happen.
And there are times too when you look at somebody maybe has some great strengths and maybe areas of opportunity to grow, and some areas of weakness that, to be honest, at times, like, it seems better to guide people away from those areas than rather than spend a lot of time trying to make somebody good at something that they're never going to be good at, right?
Right. Absolutely. And I mention this repeatedly throughout a coaching engagement, which typically lasts, you know, between 6 months to a year, depending on how much time the client has and what they want to be working on. But another aspect of this, John, is that we don't try and boil the ocean. We don't try and solve world hunger. I mean, I like to work with a client. A client may come to me and say, you know, I've been told I've got five things I need to work on. And I say, time out, slow down. Yeah. Let's start with one or two things and take it from there. Let's get really good at that and then see what we want to take on next. Often, John, just doing one or two things a little bit better makes all the difference in terms of other people's perceptions of your leadership capabilities.
Yeah, I mean, and I think that makes sense because obviously, as you say, if you try to boil the ocean, you try to focus on too many things. I mean, if you try to focus on too many things, you're going to derail everything probably because you're just so, you know, distracted at that stage.
Well, absolutely true. We have to be realistic. I mean, like you said, I worked in Silicon Valley for most of my adult life, and I know the cycles and what we have to do in the day in the life of a business leader, certainly in the technology space, but that does run across all verticals. I mean, I have clients in retail and transportation and healthcare and obviously telco, but you know, people's time is valuable, and I want to be sensitive and respectful of that time. So I don't want to give them too much. Let's do it in digestible chunks that they can manage and be successful at.
Yeah. And then obviously goal setting is critical, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So within that plan that I work with them on, and essentially they develop the coaching plan, but there is a goal, there is a specific outcome, and then there are the tactics necessary to achieve those goals. So let's say it's active listening. Why do you want to be a better active listener? Why do you want to be a good listener for yourself, for your team, and for your company? So what I want them to get a sense for is, why am I doing this, not only for me, but also for the larger organization? And then those SMART goals, I call them tactics, but they're SMART goals. They're essentially, what can you do to measure the opportunity for success? And that means make sure that they're time bound, they're specific, and measurable. So those are the things that we work on.
And then at the end of it, you know, when you're coming towards the end of an engagement, then how do you help the person you're coaching, whatever? How do you sort of bookend it and say, okay, look how far you've come?
Right. So really great question. And that comes back to measurability. So what we do is halfway through the coaching engagement, if it's a year engagement, at 6 months, I'll put together a short survey that will go out to all of the stakeholders that surrounded that client. And it'll basically ask some very specific questions. How is this client doing in these three things? There's measurability associated with that, a very simple Likert scale. I get the information back. We aggregate the data. I go over it with the client. And let's say on a continuum of -3 to +3, they score out at a +1. That's great. We've got some progress. I do the same measurement test at the end of the year cycle, and we see whether or not there's a linear progression up, that they've evolved from a +1 in terms of all the things they're doing to maybe a +2 or even a +3. So very simple scale, but measurability is key here.
And if you think about it, if you're already a successful leader, improving a couple of percentage points or whatever is probably going to have an outsized impact.
Absolutely. Very dramatic. And you know, I mean, my clients start off at all different ends of the continuum. Sure. I mean, it's rare that I have a client that's coming in at a -3 with a lot of things to fix, quote unquote, because I deal with very successful leaders. But, you know, maybe they're in that -1, that zero category. And then as they progress, they go up to +1 or +2. That's exponentially a phenomenal success. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, without obviously naming names or just abstractly, can you share a couple of real dramatic changes you've seen and what the impacts were?
Yeah, I think that, and gosh, I've got just, you know, everything from startup companies through to, you know, major multi-billion dollar enterprise organizations and clients that I've worked with. I think from a sales perspective, a couple of the sales vice presidents I've worked with, who you think of as very outgoing, very type A, very relationship type of individuals, you know, successes I've had with them often are around frustrations with organizations within their company, accounts payable, accounts receivable, areas where they know if they don't get the money in, then they don't get paid. So really having them deal with their ability to experience resilience and tolerance and composure are a very necessary element of dealing with functions within your company that aren't as gregarious and outgoing and lively as you are. So when you're dealing with finance and you're dealing with audit and you're dealing with accounts payable, you have to understand as a sales leader, how you come across from them has to be very different than how you come across to your customers outside. Yeah. And so those kind of, there are tactics to help these sales leaders work better within their company as well as outside their company.
Yeah, that's interesting. Well, I always advise people is never get on the wrong side of your finance department. It's not, it's not a good strategy for anyone.
That's right. That's
especially if you're in sales, never get on the wrong side of the finance department or the legal department. Right? You need those because they're the ones you're going to be calling up at midnight saying, you know, could you please put through some changes to this contract, and could you maybe tweak the financial terms? You're going to need both of them.
Well, and you know, there are some very simple tactics. I mean, I'll give you an example. I had one sales leader in the Miami, Florida area, and very high level, and he said, "I just can't get through to my finance team. I just keep banging my head against the wall." And I said, "Try a different tactic." I said, "Approach them with the idea of how can I help you be more successful in meeting some of the things that I need," and just that little spin on how they approach that situation allowed the finance team to sort of lessen their defense shields, lower their defense shields, so to speak, and then have an adult conversation about how they can work better together.
Yeah, and get everybody feeling like they're on the same team as opposed to internal conflict, which is, to be honest, it's the thing that sucks the life out of a lot, and it's such a waste of time.
It really does.
So in the last few minutes, Curt, what are one or two other aspects of what you do with leaders that you just want to highlight?
Yeah, I think I think another element of what we found very successful, at least in terms of developing a coaching culture within a company, which a lot of companies are excited about doing now. They see the value add of their leaders assuming more coaching sort of characteristics versus the command and control in this day and age, especially up and down the continuum of the workforce that we have from millennials all the way on up. So the styles are a little bit different. I think what we offer and what I like to see happen is being able to work with intact C-suite staffs. In other words, being able to come in and help them understand some of the areas they need to work on. Maybe it's decision-making, maybe it's negotiating skills, but how does that staff develop that dynamic and synergy together? So we'll work with the intact staff, and then my partner and I, my business partner and I, will basically take each C-suite member and build a specific customized coaching plan for them individually as part of that larger group effort. So they get coaching individually towards the larger coaching dynamic of the intact work group. And that has been very successful.
Yeah, no, that sounds like a great, I like that framework. That sounds like a great way of doing things. So you get, then you don't just get impact from one person, you get impact from a whole group. So you get individual and collective impact.
Exactly. And we want them to be successful, and we don't want, you know, we don't want to come in and give all this great advice and then just disappear. So we typically one or two quarters out, at least we'll come back for a half day and with that staff and help maybe co-facilitate a follow-up and make sure that they're doing the things they said they were going to do. It's a lot about accountability, John. It's really individually or as a team, having a coach helps them hold themselves accountable with some support, which is really what this is about, I think.
All right, fantastic. Well, listen, Curt Crosby of the Velas Coaching Group, this has been a great interview. But before we go, I'd just like you to tell people a little bit more about your group and how they can learn more about you.
Absolutely. So we are Velas Coaching here in the San Francisco Bay Area. You can look us up on www.velascoaching.com. Please feel free to link in with me as well. I'm out there, Curt Crosby. There are not too many of us. So there may be a few, but hopefully you'll recognize this face. So please feel free to link up with me, and I'd be happy to give you more information. But more importantly, I want to hear about your organizations and what you're doing out there and some of the challenges you have. So Velas Coaching is us. We're here in the San Francisco Bay Area, and we support all countries, all states. We're in Canada right now, Mexico, and the greater contingent states. So we are here to help.
Excellent. My name is John Golden, SalesPOP Online Sales Magazine and Pipeliner CRM. I will see you all for another expert interview really soon. Thank you.
Thanks, John.